simple, we are here for justice for all, and end the war, and the all dirty game outside the country of United States and inside the country of United States. We are here, and there's a chance, I will say free, free, you say Aafia free, justice for Aafia. Free, 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 justice for, justice for, justice for, justice for, now justice for all, justice for
all,
justice for all, justice for all. And the funny thing is this, we are demanding that justice for justice. That's the funniest thing that in this country, just one block before, far away from here, years before, there was a mockery of the justice system in United States history. When CIA, FBI, and the all institution who helps to create the honor for this country, and they become a reason of the downfall and the hatred of this country. The judges, judge system, without any proof, without any gun, they charge a Muslim. What a brain, a few brain in the Muslim woman's history in 21st century. They brought her over here with the two bullets in her stomach. One kid is missing and two were unknown. But thank God, the kids were recovered and they are living with the grandma in Pakistan, Karachi. So we are just demanding free, free, Aafia free. Free, 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 Aafia. Free, free, Aafia. Free, free, Aafia. We have trying to go by the sound volume because some of our law enforcement, they think that they can say to us. And we always try to never take a law in our hand. And that's what the reason we are here, and we are message to the White House, and we are message to the all powerful in this country that stay tuned with the law. We have a constitution. So I want to say thank you very much, and they will be proceeding very soon. So let's loudly, whenever somebody chants loudly, loud, and say that we want a justice. Justice will save this country's honor. No army, no FBI, no CIA. This is a clear message. It already happened in Boston, 8th of March, where she got the PhD in neuroscience. And people showed their love, respect for the justice system, and asking for and demanding for the justice of Aafia. Aafia is a symbol of justice from United States. And from all over the world, people are saying only one thing. The United States, please, before teaching to others law and constitutional things, abide by the law. Because we have a history, after, especially after the Bush administration, we have a very low, very low. So now I'm going to give the mic to Sarah Flounder, Executive Director of IAC International Action Center and part of the UNAC.
Thank you, Comrade Shahid, from the Pakistan-USA Freedom Forum. And we're gathered here today, a rally organized by the Aafia Movement, International Action Center, the United National Anti-War Coalition, and many, many organizations in unity and as part of an effort on four cities in the month of March. To really describe this, I want to ask Maury Salakhan, who is a coordinator of this effort of demonstrations and of the Aafia movement. And he'll describe both the trial of Aafia, not a trial at all. This was part of secret rendition. This was part of a kidnapping by U.S. military forces and a trial which was not at all a trial, but rather a complete and total frame-up. Maury Salakhan from the Aafia Movement. Maury?
First of all, I want to thank
our partners here in the New York area, those who are present, and those who are on the way for spearheading this effort to organize this New York branch, so to speak, of this four-city mobilization that actually began 3 days ago in Boston. I think it's important for us to put into context for those, especially those who are passing through, unexpectedly getting an earful of what this little demonstration is all about. You should know who this woman, Aafia Siddiqui, is. This month, March 2016, it marks 13 years that Dr. Aafia Siddiqui has been wrongfully imprisoned. I emphasize wrongfully imprisoned. She is a political prisoner and a prisoner of war. She is a young woman, she is still young, who came to the United States in 1990. She was 18 years old. She came to the U.S. from Pakistan full of promise, hope, expectation. She was already a very mature and very accomplished young Muslim woman. She was 18. She has a brother who resides in Houston, Texas. And she lived with her brother that first year. And she spent her freshman year at the University of Houston. That freshman year for Aafia Siddiqui was so distinguished academically that she ended up receiving a full scholarship to MIT. She went off to MIT in Boston, graduated with honors, went from MIT to Brandeis University, where she then, a few years later, acquired a PhD in cognitive neuroscience. A brilliant young person. But there was something more about Aafia Siddiqui that distinguished her above and beyond her academic prowess. It was her commitment to Islam. She was a very knowledgeable and dedicated young Muslim woman. There is actually a video of her just before she left the University of Houston for MIT. It's on YouTube. All you have to do is put in her name, Aafia Siddiqui 1991, or Aafia Siddiqui Houston, Texas, and the video comes up. And she gives this brilliant address. It's about 19 minutes long, on the rights and responsibilities of women according to the Quran and Sunnah, according to Islam. It's a brilliant address. And when the young president of the University of Houston introduced her, he announced that she had already been designated as the Dawah coordinator at MIT, even before she got there. This is how far and wide her reputation went. And so she arrives at MIT. She has a very distinguished academic sojourn there that not only involved her teaching about Islam and spreading the message of Islam among her peers and in the community at large, and putting together with another family member a charity that brought books into some of the jails and prisons to begin the process of helping to rehabilitate felons. Some of us may remember that in the 1990s there was this eruption in part of the Caucasus called Bosnia. There an eruption that resulted in terrible, terrible outrages being committed, war crimes, genocide. Aafia Siddiqui became one of the voices in the Boston area to raise humanitarian relief items that were desperately needed, boots and coats and other things that were desperately needed by the people in Bosnia who were suffering through not just a terrible war, but a bitterly cold winter. When I traveled to Boston to talk to people that knew her, one of the most senior imams in the city of Boston, his name is Abdullah Farouk, he joined us in Boston 3 days ago for the rally there and spoke up again for Aafia. He said to me, Brother Salakhan, do you remember the Bosnian crisis? And I said, yes. He said, if we were to point to one person who was most responsible for galvanizing the greater Boston area to respond to that crisis as a communal force, it was this young undergraduate by the name of Aafia Siddiqui. This is what ended up bringing her under a cloud of suspicion after the tragedy of 9/11. When activist Muslims all over the country were coming under suspicion. Regrettably, when Aafia Siddiqui left the United States in 2002 and went back home, that cloud of suspicion followed her. And one day in March of 2003, on March 30th, Aafia and her three young children, I emphasize, three young children, ages 6, 4, and 6 months, got into a taxi cab. They were on their way to the airport in Karachi to visit a maternal uncle in Islamabad, and they never made it. They never made it. The taxi was stopped, and all four of them were forcibly removed by U.S. and Pakistani agents, and then they were disappeared. On March 30th, 2003, Aafia Siddiqui and her three young children were disappeared on the basis of nothing more than suspicion. The suspicion that she was a high-ranking female functionary for Al-Qaeda. It was an absurdity. One of the most tragic absurdities to this whole story is that within a matter of days or weeks after they were disappeared, U.S. authorities came to a realization that they had made a tragic mistake. But instead of admitting they made a mistake and correcting the terrible thing they had done to this family, they have been in cover-up mode ever since. This is the greatest tragedy. Not just what happened to this young woman and her children. And even if Aafia Siddiqui was the person that Uncle Sam suspected she was, what did her children do? Why were they disappeared? Her young son, Ahmed, who was 6 years old, he was not returned to the family's home in Karachi, Pakistan, until 5 years later in 2008. The young daughter, Mariam, who was just 4 years old, she was returned to the family's home 6.5 years later in 2010. And when she was returned to the family's home, she could only speak English with an American accent, which tells us who had her all those years. The youngest child, Suleiman, who was just 6 months old, he is still missing. And we believe he died in that operation. And the reason why we believe he died is because when young Ahmed when he was finally returned to the family home and he was asked what he could remember about that fateful day. He reported that all he could remember was that he and his mother and brother and sister were in a car. They were in a taxi. They were on their way to the airport. He said strangers stopped the taxi and forced them out. And he said he remembers his mother screaming and crying. And he also remembers seeing his little brother, Suleiman, on the ground, and there was blood. What happened was when they were forced out of that taxi, young Suleiman was ripped out of his mother's arms, and he hit the ground, and his skull was probably fractured. And again, instead of the United States government and the Pakistani government admitting that they had made a terrible mistake, they had been in cover-up mode, all except for one formerly high-ranking Pakistani official, a former minister of the interior of the Musharraf government, who admitted to that mistake, to that terrible, terrible mistake, and said this is the worst mistake that he has ever made, and it's one that he will have to live with the rest of his life. Everyone else is still in denial. Aafia Siddiqui right now sits on a military base in Fort Worth, Texas, cut off from the outside world. She is a shell of her former self. The reason why we are here is to bring attention, to bring light, and to bring pressure. No one should feel oblivious to this terrible wrong that has been done. As Thomas Jefferson, one of the founding fathers of this country, said, "I tremble for my country when I reflect that God is just. His justice cannot sleep forever." Aafia symbolizes the many other disappeared in this so-called war on terrorism. She is not the only one. But her case, as the former U.S. Attorney General Ramsey Clark has said, in his opinion, is the worst case of individual injustice he has ever witnessed. And certainly, in my years of doing human rights work in America, this is the worst that I have witnessed. So with that said, this rally is going to continue with other speakers. We ask you to please remember this woman, carry her with you, offer a prayer for her and her family from time to time. But more importantly, in the United States of America, where we do still have the freedom of speech and the freedom of conscience, the freedom of association, and the freedom to act, do something. Do something with what you know. I thank you for listening.
All right. Thank you. Maury Salakhan from the Aafia Movement. I want to ask Ayub, before our next speaker, to come here and lead a few chants. I think we got to get some spirit in this, and then we're going to hear from Lynn Stewart, former political prisoner, people's lawyer, same prison where Aafia is today, and it was a people's movement that she's here with us today. So, but first we're going to do some chants. Okay.
Hold on, wake up now, wake up. Okay, I'm going to say this. What do you want? Justice. What do you want it for? Aafia. What do you want?
Justice.
What do you want it for?
Aafia.
What do you want?
Justice.
What do you want it for?
Aafia.
What do you want?
Justice.
What do you want it for?
Aafia.
What do you want?
Justice.
What do you want it for?
Aafia.
What do you want?
Justice.
What do you want it for?
Aafia.
What do you want?
Justice.
What do you want it for?
Aafia.
What do you want?
Justice.
What do you want it for?
Aafia.
The next is justice for Aafia. Justice. Now, justice for Aafia. Justice now. Justice for Aafia. Justice now! Justice for Aafia! 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 Justice now! Justice
for Aafia!
Justice
now!
Justice
for Aafia!
Justice
now!
Justice
now!
Thank you. And I think Ayub will be coming back, the next speaker or two, because we want to show this is a people's struggle. Now, our next speaker, the only way home for Aafia is a people's movement. It's a people in the streets. It's a demands in city after city, because her trial was not a trial. And the prison is a solitary confinement. And we all know that every day of Aafia's trial, she would tell the court and she would tell the spectators, I was tortured. She would demand an end to the torture that came every day when she was strip searched to be brought into court. And for that, she was declared disrupting her own trial. So that's just part of the crime. You can imagine what's happening to her now in solitary confinement in prison just outside of Fort Worth. But the people's movement that will free and repatriate Aafia Siddiqui, we're going to hear now from Lynn Stewart, who's here with us today because of a people's movement. People's hero, Lynn Stewart.
Making all those guys at Homeland Security up there nervous. I don't think of anyone at this particular juncture of history that I'd rather speak on behalf of than Aafia Siddiqui. She is really the crossroads. Educated in the United States, went back to her own country, was rounded up there, was tortured at Bagram, a name that should be as infamous as Alcatraz is to us Americans. Split from her children, can you think of anything worse? She still doesn't know where one of them ended up. And now she's confined in Carswell. Carswell, one of the best kept secrets, is a very small prison building in which they house women that they consider both crazy, and I use that word advisedly, or they consider political. The three people that I know of that are there are, of course, Aafia. Secondly, Ana Belen Montes, Puerto Rican American, who acted on conscience and shared so-called secrets with Cuba because she thought it was the right thing to do to enable the Cuban people to act in self-defense. And of course, a third most famous is Marius Mason, who tried to save the laboratory animals, who was an activist for Earth First. So those three sort of represent what International Women's Day, International Women's Month, International Women are all about, but most particularly Aafia. And although this gathering is not enormous, I understand from those like Sarah Flounders who have been to Pakistan and have seen the tremendous local support Aafia receives. She is a heroine, a hero, so we're not being sexist here, but she is someone that all Pakistanis are aware of. They campaign for her. They want her to come home. Her conviction at the courthouse a few blocks away here was a travesty. The wall pointed away from her. But because she did not have the most skilled representation and because she was so beside herself from the levels of her, okay, I'm getting in the way of the photographers, they can't get my lovely face in. Anyway, she was so distraught by reason of having been tortured in Pakistan before she came here, an arduous trip here, and then having counsel, legal counsel, that was probably not up to what she wanted to do. As you know, I'm a great believer in client-centered. No, it's in the way of the photographers. Let's go. They don't want it. I'm getting bossed around by a man on international. I ask you all. No. But at any rate, this is Aafia's day, and I say that she got not a trial, but a sham. The judge was only too happy to sentence her to enormous time. She was, according to what I heard, quote, her own worst enemy, which makes me know her lawyers were not representing her and her interest and what she wanted to say at that trial. They wanted to do business as usual, go through the motions, get the conviction, speak up at sentencing, and go off and spend the rest of your life in God-forsaken Carswell. But I don't think it's God-forsaken for Aafia. I'm sure her faith is one of the things that sustains her. I'm sure that she is as she was, and I'm hopeful that even though she is basically incommunicado, it is more of a self-imposed protection, that she has refused to be public because she feels that is the only way she can be protected from the forces that would like to see her silenced. I hope that this will end. I hope that we will be able to build enough of a movement in this country to support her and make her confident that she can speak out, that she can come forward, that it's not all in vain. She is a remarkable woman. She studied remarkably. She came out the other end, and she is the recipient, as I said, of not hundreds, but many, many thousands who will turn out to ask for her freedom. We are not many, many. We are few, but we can be as stalwart and strong and dedicated to her as the people of Pakistan are. We can stand up for Aafia. It is a rare opportunity to stand for someone of such international stature, to show solidarity with Muslims. Take that, Mr. Trump, and go forward on her behalf today and every day. These campaigns, as we learned, and I learned through Ralph Pointer here, and Betty Davis standing down below, these are campaigns on the long haul. They don't end tomorrow. We have to keep at them. That's why I'm glad this campaign goes from here to Washington to Fort Worth. Now, Fort Worth is not very fertile soil, let me tell you. But whatever it is, it keeps the spark alive. It keeps spark alive for Aafia, and hopefully it will give her the heart to understand that there are people out here fighting for her, and that we will not stop until she is back home. Home, the most beautiful word a prisoner can hear. Thank you all for coming out. Thank you. Yeah, don't you fall down the steps. That would be a tragedy. Today, as we're gathered here, we're also going to march over to the prison where Aafia Siddiqui was held during her trial here and held in isolation and solitary for months leading up to her trial.
First, we're going to hear from a few more speakers. Our next speaker will be Joe Lombardo from the United National Anti-War Coalition. Joe Lombardo was also one of the people who went to Pakistan to help raise the case of Aafia Siddiqui. And I want to say, when I was in Pakistan with Aafia Siddiqui's family, that tens and tens of thousands of people come out again and again and again on the streets in huge demonstrations. This is a case that everyone in Pakistan knows, that every political party, right to left, secular to religious, has again and again demanded the repatriation, the return of Aafia Siddiqui, who is a Pakistani citizen, who was kidnapped in Pakistan and held in solitary in Afghanistan, and then brought here strictly for a show trial, not for any kind of justice that doesn't exist in U.S. courts. So next we're going to hear from Joe Lombardo of United National Anti-War Coalition.
Thank you, and thank you for all of you for being here. Lynn said there's not many of us. And the reason there's not many of us is because people don't know the name of Aafia Siddiqui. If you walk up and down the street and ask people who is Aafia Siddiqui, they could not answer it. But if the people of the United States knew who Aafia Siddiqui is, if they knew what happened to her, there would be tremendous support for her. So we need to keep out having demonstrations like this. We need to get out in the public. We need to make her name known. Sarah said I was in Pakistan. In 2012, I went with a group of 31 anti-war activists to Pakistan. And we went with thousands and thousands and thousands of Pakistanis from Islamabad up to Waziristan, where the US drones are killing people. We met three times with the US ambassador to Pakistan. He denied that any civilians were killed. But the people of Pakistan brought us their pictures. They brought us their names, and they have documented the thousands that have been killed by US drone strikes. While we were there, another leader from UNAC and myself went down to Karachi, and we met with the family of Aafia Siddiqui. It was quite an amazing experience. We got off the plane, and we were met by a big banner and lots of people in the airport welcoming us. They brought us in a car. As we were driving down the streets of Karachi, there was a sound truck that was there, and it started chanting for Aafia Siddiqui and playing a popular folk song that was written for her. And we turned into a street that was perhaps twice as wide as Broadway here. And it was filled for blocks and blocks and blocks with people for Aafia Siddiqui and to greet the Americans that were there to help her. She has been named the daughter of the country. They have held a demonstration in Pakistan of over a million people. So when you see an idiot like Donald Trump who gets up and say that Muslims hate us, well, if you don't want to be hated, you got to change policies. The policies like they have done in Pakistan are against all the people of Pakistan. And they wanted to know over and over again, why does your country think it can bomb our people? And I want to know too, why our country thinks it has the right to bomb people. If you want to end the so-called war against terror, a war against terror is something that can never end. You can beat an army, you can beat a country, but an idea of terrorism, a thought, a concept, how do you beat that? It means we will have war forever. But if you want to end the war against terror, if you want to end the hatred against our country, then you have to end policies like the United States is doing overseas, and you have to free Aafia Siddiqui, the daughter of the country of Pakistan that millions have come out into support. It's not just Aafia Siddiqui that's in prison in these countries. There are many, many political prisoners. Lynn was one of them. But do you know we have special Muslim prisons in this country? They're called communication management units. Hundreds of Muslims have been rounded up in these preemptive prosecutions where the FBI sends people into mosques and tries to trick them, to get them to do something that they can then say is illegal. And they can then say, you see what Muslims do, and it can justify their wars in Muslim countries. You take the case, for instance, right up the river here of the Newburgh Four. They sent someone into the mosque there, and they were poor people. There were people that did not have jobs. And they said, we want to go and blow up. This is a FBI agent saying this to the people in the mosques. We want to go up and blow up a synagogue. And they said, no, we don't do that. We're not doing that. He said, I will give you $5,000 to do it. He said, no, we're not doing it. The money kept on raising and raising and raising till it got to $250,000. And they said, okay. But they talked among themselves and they understood this guy was crazy. But if he had this kind of money, they needed the money. They were going to take it. It's a bad thing to do. But they were not going to blow up a synagogue. But today they are in prison, like hundreds of other Muslims. We have to defend all the Muslim political prisoners. We have to defend all the political prisoners. And we have to get Aafia out of prison and get her repatriated back to Pakistan. Thank you.
Thank you, Joe Lombardo from UNAM. And just as Joe Lombardo gets off, I want to invite everybody to a rally on Sunday at Herald Square, where we'll again be raising Aafia Siddiqui's name, a demand for her freedom, her repatriation, her return to Pakistan. It's Sunday, 2 p.m., and the focus is that none of the major candidates are speaking about the war. We have to demand an end to the war at home and abroad, an end to Islamophobia, a defense of the Black Lives Matter movement, and a demand to rebuild Flint, rebuild all our cities, and end the wars, the endless wars. So that's going to be Sunday at 2 o'clock, Herald Square, that's 34th Street and 6th Avenue, and I do hope everyone here will come out again, and again we're going to demand freedom for Aafia Siddiqui, there and everywhere. Next up, we're going to ask Fahad Ahmed and also Shahina from Drum, who is a mother of Mateen Siraj, who is a political prisoner, Muslim prisoner, held under the most difficult conditions, also part of the show trials that happened here in New York City, happened across the country. Drum, Desi's rising up and moving, has been so much a part of the movement for the release of these prisoners and for the demands for justice.
Assalamu alaikum. میرا نام شہینہ پروین ہے میں شاہوار متین سراج کی ماں ہوں
My name is Shahina Parveen and I am the mother of Shahwar Mateen Siraj
جیسے کہ سب لوگ بلکہ ساری دنیا یہ جانتی ہے کہ 9/11 کے بعد نہ صرف امریکہ کے اندر بلکہ ساری دنیا میں مسلمانوں پر قیامت ٹوٹ پڑی
As people, not only in this country, but across the world know that after 9/11, not only in America, but across the world, the heavens fell upon the lives of Muslims.
Meri hamvatan, sister, Pakistani Musliman, Aafia Siddiqui, jise उसके नन्हे बच्चों के साथ किडनैप किया गया और अलग अलग जगहों से खुफिया जेलों में डालकर तशद्दुद का निशाना बनाया गया और आखिरकार इसे अमेरिका के में लाकर उसे खुफिया और ऐसी खतरनाक जेल में डाला गया, CMU जिसे ब्लैक होल कहते हैं, उसमें फेंक दिया गया।
And Aafia, who is from my country, who's my sister, who's Pakistani, who's Muslim, who was snatched away from her young kids, and then her and her kids scattered across to secret prisons across the country, across the world, and then finally brought here into America, put into a show trial, and thrown away into a black hole of a prison.
Maa ki mamta par zulm kiya gaya. Ek masoom aurat, meri sister, Pakistani sister, jiski izzat ki bhi hifazat nahi ki gayi.
And this is torture upon my sister, a Pakistani sister, whose honor has been disrespected and taken away from her.
Mujhse zyada kaun samajh sakta hai? Meri aman pasand peaceful family ke saath bhi America ke andar ek khud saata jhoote case mein mere bete ko NYPD, FBI ne milkar paid agent aur undercover ke zariye jhoote case mein phasaya aur $100,000 diye aur great life di use.
And nobody can understand this better than me, as my son was targeted by a joint operation of the NYPD in collaboration with the CIA for their surveillance program here in New York City. And an informant that was paid $100,000 went after my son, targeted him, manipulated him, entrapped him, and sent him away to prison.
And he should be. What the hell? And he said, 30 years ago, lambi saza di gayi, kuch na karne ki. Usne koi act nahi kiya. Usko koi Miranda rights nahi mile. Usko koi bhi warrant nahi dikhaya gaya. Usne mana kiya. Balki us agent ke saath koi raabta bhi nahi kiya.
And my son is now serving a 30-year sentence for not having done anything, for not having undertaken any acts. His rights were deprived on every level and at every step of the process. And he completely disagreed with the agent that kept trying to entrap him, and his last contact with the agent was to break off the relationship with him. Yet he was still arrested and put on trial and sentenced.
Isko 2004 mein Republican National Convention ke liye istemal kiya gaya, jis tarah aaj इस इलेक्शन में जो हो रहे हैं मुसलमानों के खिलाफ ये किया जा रहा है कि मुसलमान नफरत करते हैं, मुसलमान किसी से नफरत नहीं करते, ये हमारे इस्लाम में है ही नहीं।
And just as my son was arrested days before the Republican National Convention to use his case to manipulate people, to incite people, similarly we see now that with this election they are manipulating public opinion by using Muslims as scapegoats. They claim that Muslims hate people, but we know for a fact that none of this is true. We see what are the beliefs of Muslims. We know what are the precepts of Islam. We know that none of this is true.
Not sirf ye, balki jis din mere bete ko saza sunai gayi, jise sachcha insaaf nahi diya gaya, usi din aadhi raat ko hamara case process mein tha aur inhone puri family ko ghar se uthaya aur jail mein dala.
And the same day that my son was sentenced, that same night, immigration came and raided our house and arrested me, my daughter, and my husband, even though we had an immigration case pending.
Not sirf main, not sirf meri sister Aafia, bahut sari maaye aur behne hain jinke bachon ko, jinke shohron ko, jinke logon ko isi tarah jhoote keson mein phasaya gaya hai.
I am not alone. Aafia is not alone. There are many women whose sons, whose husbands, whose loved ones have been thrown into false manufactured cases and locked away away from them forever.
Bas, President Obama, jaate jaate ek neki kar lo. Wazir-e-Azam Nawaz Sharif saab, Sadr-e-Pakistan, ek neki kar le. Hum maa behno ko, hum Pakistan se hain. Hamare upar jo zulm hua, usko khatam karwaye. President Obama se baat kare. Aur President Obama, please, Aafia Siddiqui ko, jo begunah hai, usse riha kare. Aur inke saath, jo bahut sare log yahan jailon mein hain, CMU mein hain, jin par itna shadid torture hota hai, jo main aapko bata nahi sakti, in sabko riha kare, ek chance de, inko maaf kare. Ye kasoorwar nahi hai, ye begunah hai. Inko jailon se riha kiya jaye. Aur Aafia Siddiqui ko inke bachchon tak pahunchaya jaye. Ye dil dil maar rahe hain.
And so we demand that the President Obama, before he finishes his term, try to do one good act for his whole legacy. We request the Prime Minister of Pakistan, we request the President of Pakistan to intervene on behalf of these cases, to bring Aafia home, to bring our loved ones home, to bring the loved ones of all who are locked away, bring them home, back to their families, back to their homes.
हम औरतें हैं, हम माएं हैं, हम बहनें हैं, हम आप लोगों की, पाकिस्तान की, मुसलमानों की माएं, इज्जत है हम आपकी, प्लीज हमारे बच्चों को, हमारी बहन को और दूसरे तमाम कैदियों को एक चांस दिया जाए, उनको रिहा किया जाए, हर कैदी को जुल्म रोक दिया जाए.
So as mothers, as sisters, as women, we stand here to demand freedom, to demand the return of these people back to their homes and back to their families, that they should be given another chance to be home with their people.
Aisi policies banaye jo tashaddud khatam karte. Tashaddud kya hai kisi ko nahi pata. Ye maa janti hai, ye behan janti hai. Ye tashaddud khatam karwaye. Hum America mein isliye nahi aaye the. Hum kisi se nafrat nahi karte. Hum acche musalman hain.
Thank you.
Thank you, Shahina and Fahad from Drum. And this is another prisoner who cannot be forgotten. I next want to invite up an attorney, Scott Fenstermacher, who was the U.S. military assigned to represent at Guantanamo a prisoner. And thousands and thousands of people were swept up in the U.S. war on terror. We can never forget that of those held at Guantanamo, it turned out 92%. This was U.S. figures. They had no evidence on at all. So, including from youths, age 15 up to 79. These were the kind of folks who were simply swept up, sold for bounty, and so on. And the cases go on and on. So, we're going to ask Scott Fenstermacher to be next up.
Good afternoon. Thank you very much for being here today. I represented a number of the detainees at Guantanamo Bay, including a gentleman by the name of Omar al-Baluchi. Omar al-Baluchi is one of the five detainees at Guantanamo Bay who is accused of helping perpetrate the 9/11 attacks, and he's also the nephew of Khalid Sheikh Mohammed. In furtherance of the government's propaganda effort to demonize Aafia Siddiqui, the government alleged that Ms. Siddiqui and Mr. al-Baluchi were formerly married. They did that in order to further propagandize their case against Ms. Siddiqui, to demonize her and to facilitate her railroading and conviction here in New York. Now, I am a graduate of an American terrorist training camp. I went to college at a place called the United States Air Force Academy, which is a terrorist training camp for the American government. When I was when I myself was a terrorist for the United States of America, my job was to help plan for and facilitate an all-out nuclear weapons attack against the Soviet Union, which would have killed tens of millions or hundreds of millions of people. And that was my job as an Air Force officer. Now, after I got out of the Air Force and had time to reflect on what I had done when I was in the service, I realized that I put in context exactly who are the terrorists and what terrorists are. It's very difficult for us to point fingers at others when we have 5,000 nuclear warheads targeted at God knows who, God knows where. Now, as when Lynn Stewart spoke before, she mentioned the fact that when Aafia Siddiqui was tried here in New York, her attorneys did not put on her defense. When I was representing Mr. Albalucci at Guantanamo Bay, I was willing to put on his defense. And because I was willing to put on his defense, and because I am a former terrorist myself, the government suspended me from practicing before the military commissions at Guantanamo Bay and replaced me with government hacks who are now in the process of railroading him and his other four defendants in the Guantanamo Bay 9/11 case. The reason I mention all of this is that as a former Air Force officer and as a honors graduate of Harvard Law School, I will tell you that the fact pattern that the government, the United States government, cooked up to railroad Aafia Siddiqui is patently silly, false, fraudulent, and a joke. It's a sham. There is no possible way that military personnel in the United States government would permit Aafia Siddiqui to do what they claim that she did. And the reason that they cooked this story up is to railroad her and put her away for what it is going to amount to the rest of her life. The question is, why does our government do this? Why does our government railroad somebody like Aafia Siddiqui? And why does it suspend attorneys like me who graduated near the top of their class from the United States Air Force Academy and graduated with honors from Harvard Law School? The reason for that is that all of these cases are propaganda shows. They are propaganda shows in order to demonize Muslims and to legitimize a war which, in its very essence, is a war of aggression. It is an offensive war. It is not a defensive war. It is a war to establish American and Western hegemony throughout the world, and particularly in the resource-rich area of the Middle East. I would urge each of you to continue to attend these types of events, speak out on behalf of Dr. Siddiqui, and not let our government and its so-called allies have a moment's rest as long as there's one innocent Muslim in jail anywhere in the world, whether it's in Carswell Air Force Base, Guantanamo Bay, Florence, Colorado, or the MCC. Thank you very much for being here. Again. What do we want?
Justice.
What do we want?
Justice.
What do you want it for?
America.
What do you want?
Justice.
What do you want it for?
America.
What do you want?
Justice.
What do you want it for?
America.
What do you want?
Justice.
What do you want?
America.
What do you want it for?
America.
Justice for Aafia. Justice now. 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 Send Aafia home. Send her 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 now.
Yes, sir.
Thank you, Ayub. Next up, we're going to hear from a volunteer who's been working hard for the Aafia movement, Raid Bazaar.
Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. It's an honor to be here tonight, to have my voice heard all around the world, to demand the immediate release, to demand justice for the political prisoner, Sister Aafia Siddiqui. We demand her to return home for her family, for her children who are waiting so eagerly for her. We demand for Sister Aafia Siddiqui to be repatriated back to Pakistan. The tragedy of Sister Aafia Siddiqui is so amazing in that it brought all of us together. Muslims, non-Muslims, human beings, humanitarians. I came from work, ladies and gentlemen, just now. I was so tired and exhausted. But to come here and to hear about the situation of Sister Aafia Siddiqui, it brings so much pain and so much uncertainty about the future of Muslims in this country, about the future of Islam. Ladies and gentlemen, I don't want to change the topic, but tonight, we are here tonight for Sister Aafia Siddiqui. We are here peacefully protesting for her release. We demand that she is returned home. We demand that she gets compensated for all the pain and suffering that she is put to. And here, my voice is not only for Sister Aafia Siddiqui. There are millions and millions of Sisters Aafia Siddiqui who are held in prisons around the world. We are here to demand the immediate release of Sister Aafia Siddiqui, of all the political prisoners who are put behind bars for no reasons. For reasons that are put together for false reasons. We demand a new trial for Sister Aafia Siddiqui. We demand our voices to be heard. We demand for her to be released. And I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bring all of us together and to make this movement grow more and more. We become louder till our voice is heard and that this poor woman is returned home for her family and for her children. Thank you very much. I'm not a speaker. I'm not good at speaking, but I said what came to my heart, and I say it one more time. We demand the release of Sister Aafia Siddiqui, urgent as now, as the sister said, before President Obama steps down. We kindly ask the president to do anything that he can to let go of Sister Aafia Siddiqui from prison. Thank you very much, and God bless you.
Before our next speaker, just to say that we're going to march soon to the prison and back. It's a short walk that we're talking about, a 10-minute walk. We have a few more speakers, but I asked to have come up on the stage Shafiq Ahmad, who is a father of Farouk, who is a prisoner held in Indiana in Terre Haute prison, one of so many, many prisoners. Muslim prisoners rounded up, hardly a trial, for doing nothing. And we have to remember this is part of the mood, the climate of Islamophobia that today allows a Donald Trump to denounce all Muslims, that stops the building of Islamic centers across the country. It's part of the wars that the U.S. is waging on countries around the world. I then want to please bring up Mazeda Uddin from the South Asian Fund for Education and Scholarship, a supporter also of Aafia Siddiqui and a Bangladesh community activist. Mazeda.
Assalamu alaikum, everyone. This is our woman month, and it is injustice for our women for nothing. This country cannot be go like this. Aafia cannot be for nothing to be sufferer and a prison. This is cannot be go away. We have to demand Aafia to be released in this month, woman month. Other day, I was knocked by rock in my car because I wear a hijab. And someone followed me up to my house and threw the rock in my car because I wear a hijab. I am a Muslim woman. Now I realize how Dr. Aafia is surviving, how she can treat it, how she is embarrassed, discrimination, and for nothing. America Republican camp is now is planning to throw out Muslim from this country. Who cannot be like this? America by immigrant. We want Dr. Aafia should be released as soon as possible. If needed, will be civil disobedience to get release her. I was civil disobedience for an immigrant Muslim woman. Now we want to release her as soon as possible. If needed, we will be accompanied, combined to demonstration in front of immigration office as soon as possible all over that. If needed, we will go in front of White House, say, Obama, please, this month is our woman month. Please release her. It cannot be going before. You are not the president. When you are president, you should have to talk our women agenda, release her as soon as possible, as long as you are in president. Thank you.
Thank you, Mazeda Udin from the South Asian Fund for Education and Scholarship. We next want to ask, please, to come up Salim Malik, who is with a Pakistani-American think tank. Salim Malik.
Good afternoon. Assalamu alaikum, ladies and gentlemen. I'm just repeating the Prime Minister Churchill in Second World War when he said, if the justice system are working, then nobody will defeat us. So I'm speaking loud and clear. If there is a no free trial, there is a no justice. If there is a no justice, then there is a no multi-ethnic free civil society. And let me tell you one thing, as a first immigrant, we are the more American than born American. We are the more American than born American. We love this country. But if something going wrong, then we have to raise the voice, and nobody stop the voices of the common man of this world. Nobody stop the voices of the common man of this country. And the voice is that, please free Dr. Aafia Siddiqui. This is a voice of past, present, and inshallah would be future. And Pakistani American think tank, as a Secretary General of Pakistani American think tank, we will always support this, any cause, any injustice, any part of the country, and thank you very much.
I think if Ayub could come up and help lead a few chants, we want to be ready to march out in just a couple of minutes. I think we're going to use this front banner here. If everyone has signs, we're going to get down to Worth Street, then to the federal prison, MCC, and back here. But we'll do some chants first. And just for everyone who has come out, we hope you'll come again for a major, really a rally to say that none of the candidates are addressing the wars. And the wars go on day after day. 2 days ago, a drone attack killed 150 people in Somalia. We know absolutely nothing about them, but everyone assumes, of course, they were guilty if the U.S. fired drones and hellfire missiles and killed 150 people. But when we look at 92% of all the people held at Guantanamo, they found they had no evidence on, we really wonder who are the targets now of the drone attacks. The mass killings that go on, the bombs that drop, it's because now they're afraid to put anyone on trial. They find they have no evidence. So really, the terrorists are right here. And every time we challenge them, and every time we call for the release of those who are unjustly held, this really is a sign to them they're not in isolation. There are people around the world and also right here who stand up to the U.S. government, who say no to U.S. terrorism, who speak out
who organize, who demand an end to the wars abroad and right here at home. The poisoning, the roundups, the mass incarceration in the U.S., that's a war coming home. So Ayuba, we're going to do some chants. Really, Aafia Siddiqui is very much in our minds and our hearts here today because of the terrible injustice and crime committed against her. But as you see, it's linked to all the many crimes.
Yeah, just before we chant, brother, just one remark. Brother, this country is still the most powerful country. The world is still looking at the USA as a role model. So if people like Aafia don't get justice in the United States, what's the message that is going to the other countries? Brothers, what do we want?
Justice.
What who don't want it for?
Aafia.
What they want?
Justice.
What they want it for?
Aafia.
What they want?
Justice.
What they want it for?
Aafia.
What they want?
Justice.
What they want it for?
Aafia.
What they want?
Justice.
Justice for Aafia. Justice now. 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 Send Aafia home. Send her 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 now. The other thing before I go up is, brothers, 6 years ago, I get my citizenship right here. And for you brothers, who can I get your citizenship here or somewhere else? For your brothers and sisters, for your in-laws. If you want America to be better, you have to denounce injustices when you say it. When you see it happening, as an American citizen, the best thing you can do is to stand for justice and to denounce injustices. But to go on and to leave your brother and sister like Aafia, that's not what you're supposed to be. As a good American, you have to stand for justice. All right.
Speaker from the Samidun Palestine Prisoners Solidarity Network, who's here today, and their demonstrations again and again have been against a private military contracting company, one of the largest employers in the world, and they run the prisons right here in the U.S., including the immigration prisons right here at this building. And also the prisons in Palestine. They run some of the secret prisons. They're part of the whole apparatus of terror. They've been demonstrating weekly in front of the G4S office at West 44th Street, but today they're here with us. So please welcome Joe Catron.
Thank you, Sarah. It's great to see everyone here today. I don't have much to say other than that we're very happy to be here with you, standing in solidarity with Dr. Aafia Siddiqui. We are supporters of all prisoners held by U.S. imperialism and its allies. We recognize the case of Aafia Siddiqui as one not only of grave injustice against an individual, but as a part of the United States' entire imperialist project in the Middle East. So we see our causes as one, and we're very happy to be here. Thank you.
Justice for Aafia! Justice now! Justice for Aafia! Justice now! Justice for Aafia!
sisters, I just wanted to point something out to you before we begin our march. We're about to begin the march, and I hope that everyone who is able-bodied will stay with us and return back with us from this short march we're going to take. But just in case for those who may not, on the table we brought some copies of a small book by a very well-known and respected Muslim scholar, Dr. Tariq Ramadan, on Islam's perspective on social justice. We want to encourage everyone to take a copy. They're free. If you're in a position to make a donation to this campaign for Aafia Siddiqui, this four-city mobilization, we would appreciate it because it's ongoing. We're halfway through. On the 19th, a week from tomorrow, we will be in Washington, D.C. And then on the 30th, we'll be in Fort Worth, Texas, outside the military base where she's being held. And this is very resource intensive, so whatever you can put in the box would be appreciated. But with that said, we are about to begin our march. And we hope that everyone who is able to join us will stay with us from start to finish.
Free Aafia now! 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 NCC, which is really a hellhole and a dungeon. It's like the Bastille of New York City, where so many prisoners have been kept in real isolation. And we can also both remember during Aafia's trial, during Lynn Stewart's trial. We were here again and again, and through so many of the other trials at this same prison. So we're going there today, even though we don't know the names of the people who are held there right now. But we know they won't get any more justice there than any of the other prisoners who've been held.
Thank you. All right.
Okay. So we'll head over.
Free Aafia now!
Everyone there!
Aafia now! Free Aafia now!
Free Aafia now! Free Aafia now! Free Aafia now! Free Aafia now! Free Aafia now! Free Aafia now! Free Aafia now!
Justice for Aafia!
Justice for Aafia! Justice for Aafia! Justice for Aafia! Justice for Aafia! Justice for Aafia! Justice for Aafia! Justice for Aafia! Justice for Aafia! Justice for Aafia! Justice for Aafia!
Justice for Aafia! Justice for Aafia!
Justice for Aafia! Justice for Aafia! Justice for Aafia!
Security in a war on terrorism. Terrorism is being perpetrated against innocent people in the name of a war on terrorism. And this is something that we should all take to heart as we prepare to leave this space that we've occupied for the last couple of hours. You heard from a mother Sister Shahina concerning her son. There's also a father here whose son Farouk became one of those faceless, for far too many Americans, faceless, nameless persons who ended up being targeted and set up in very, very unfortunate ways in order to help fan the propaganda about the propaganda of fear in this country, to justify things that in a healthy America are just not justifiable. I often reflect over the late Senator J. William Fulbright's observation in a book that he wrote entitled The Arrogance of Power. And for those of us who may not be familiar with who this man, J. William Fulbright, is, he is actually the person that the Fulbright Scholarship is named after. He was a senator who at that time was the longest presiding senator over one of the most powerful committees in the Senate Foreign Relations Committee. And as he was nearing the twilight of his career and reflecting back on things that he had witnessed, things that he had done, things that he had experienced, he ended up writing this very thought-provoking book entitled The Arrogance of Power. I would encourage you to go to a library and find it, or go to Amazon and look it up and find it and read this book, The Arrogance of Power. In it, he talks about two Americas. He describes two Americas. The one he describes as the America of Lincoln and Adlai Stevenson, and the other the America of Teddy Roosevelt and the modern super patriots. One he describes as being compassionate and introspective, and the other arrogant in the use of great power. We have been seeing too much of that other America. Certainly in my lifetime, I've seen too much of the ugly America. And I don't say these words as someone who hates the United States of America. When I was coming into, we were driving into New York today on the Brian, is it Lehrer show? They were talking about a remark, one of the many outrageous remarks that Trump has made during the course of this campaign, where in this case he accused Muslims of hating America. We just hate America. And that is not true. I was born and raised in this country. The roots of my family go generations deep in the soil of this land. And as a Muslim, I view this country as part of a global community that comes from God. I know that there are certain families in this country that have the tendency to think that that America belongs to them, that this is their backyard. But that is not so. We are inheritors of a small part of this earth for a time. And when we leave this world the way we came in, with nothing. We go out of this world with nothing except our deeds. And so this is a country that I love. And in the work that we do, in the criticism that I level that criticism out of love, because I want this country to live up to the better part of itself. This is what it takes. It takes people being willing to come out into the streets and generate pressure in order to force America to live up to the better part of itself. This is what it takes. And I want to humbly apologize on behalf of my community. We live in this city of New York with, I know there has to be probably a million Muslims in and on the outskirts of New York City. At least a million Muslims. This square should have been full of Muslims. But as you all know, so many of us right now are living in fear, despite the faith we're supposed to have. We're supposed to, our faith is supposed to challenge any fear we might experience. But that is not so. And so, you know, I thank our non-Muslim brethren for taking up the slack. I thank you for being here, for a Muslim woman that you understand has been dealt with in a very, very ugly and monstrous way. And I want to also thank you for reminding the Muslims that are here, those Muslims that are here, that everyone, every non-Muslim is not like the blind following robotic Trump followers that we're seeing too much of these days in the media. That there are good-hearted people in this country that understand the difference between right and wrong, between truth and falsehood, between justice and injustice. And this is what it's going to take in order for us to push back and to help this country to live up to the better part of itself. I can't wait to report to Aafia's family about now we have two very spirited mobilizations that have just taken place that are now behind us. The one in Boston 3 days ago and the one here in New York City today. Now, 1 week from tomorrow, we will be in Washington, D.C., in front of the Justice Department. And then on the 30th of this month, we will be right outside that military base in Fort Worth, Texas. And inshallah, to Allah, God willing, we will be raising as much ire there as we did here today, and they will hear us. And they will know that this Muslim woman that they have had in their captivity for much too long is not alone. They might have her in isolation, but she is not alone. So again, I thank you. May God bless you.